Specifically on non-fiction film, but it's a great deal of fun. I've been going for the last 5 or 6 years, I think. It runs from a Thursday to a Sunday, and you basically run around and cram as many films as you can. It's a really fun festival because it's not just film, it's also music. They have buskers before each screening, and the musicians come in from all over the country to play, and they're just completely styles of music. You never know what you're going to get. One morning I had like the Missouri Symphony Orchestra, and then, you know, I had like a new wave synth rock dance band, you know, really fascinating groups. And then they also have parties, they have talks with filmmakers. The filmmakers do come in for their films. There's one award, and it is for an achievement in the art of nonfiction work. You know, it's announced in advance, and this year it went to Bill and Turner Ross, who are brothers that play with the nonfiction genre, and they've made a number of films, most recently contemporary color western, and then they came with their latest film, Bloody Nose, Empty Pockets, which I'll talk about a little bit later. So they got the True Vision Award. The selection of films is really interesting because you will get films that you may never have the opportunity to see anywhere. And then you'll also get films like Crip Camp, which we got, which is debuting on Netflix in a week or two, or Dick Johnson Is Dead, which has also been picked up by Netflix. So you'll get those, but you'll also get films that you definitely feel so lucky to have seen because you're not going to get the opportunity otherwise. So that's a little bit about the festival. It's very exhausting, but it's a lot of fun. So this year, I saw 11, 12. I did see 12. I'll just kind of go briefly through them. I'll just kind of recap them and tell you what I think of them, and so that if you are interested in seeing them when they get released, they're on your radar. Thursday night, I saw 3 films. I saw Some Kind of Heaven, which is directed by Lance Oppenheim, and Some Kind of Heaven debuted at Sundance, I believe. It is this fascinating portrait of the Villages. It's a retirement city in Florida, and it focuses on, I think, 3 or 4 different residents. One is a married couple, a couple are single, and there's a lot going on in this town, and it's just kind of a fascinating look at how this place, which was built Disneyland for retirees, still ends up having a lot of the same, you know, utopia isn't all it's cracked up to be, I guess is what my tagline would be for it. But it's beautifully shot, and the subjects are very fascinating. It's a little bit subversive, which I like. It's a very entertaining film. So after Some Kind of Heaven on Thursday, I saw Time, which was also at Sundance, also very good. It follows a woman by the name of Fox Rich. It takes her videotapes that she shot herself 20 years ago when her husband went to prison. It follows her family. She has 5 sons, I believe, that she raised while her husband was in prison, and she is trying to get him out of prison because I believe he is sentenced to 60 years for a robbery. She basically is trying to get clemency for him because that sentence would pretty much be a lifetime sentence for him. So it shows her and how she kind of picked up the pieces of her life. It's beautiful looking, it's black and white, and it really shows the perseverance of a family that's separated because because there's so much love in this family, and it's so obvious in her sons, you know, for all the responsibility she had, she took it and she ran with it, and it's a really lovely portrait. I really enjoyed it. And the last film I saw on Thursday was called Faith. That is a film that, unfortunately, we did not have a Q&A after, and I really wish we did, because I really fight in the event of Armageddon. I really liked it, but I wasn't sure exactly how much of what I was watching was real, I guess. And I really would have loved to hear the director talk, but I'll have to dig into that one a little bit more on my own. Friday, I saw a film called Love Mobile, which was shot in Germany. Essentially on the side of these German roads. The women are sex workers, and the trailers are for clients to come. It deals with a lot of things. It's also very gorgeous, gorgeously shot, and pretty incredible because you're shooting most of the time in a camper van, which is, I cannot be easy. I just follow these two particular women as they try to make money doing this, and it's very difficult because they're also paying rent, and to me, it feels more like a cycle of sexual exploitation. You know, these women are coming in from other countries and doing this to make money, and they're not treated very well, and have to decide if this is what they want to keep doing. So it's an interesting portrait. Also, I saw an amazing film. I think it should be required viewing. It's called The Viewing Booth. So The Viewing Booth is a very simple premise, which is, doing a study, and he's observing how people observe specific videos that he selected on YouTube to watch about the Israeli occupation of Palestine. He has, like, I think there's 20 videos. He observes the people in the booth watching the videos, and they can click on any video they want, and then they would have to kind of talk about what they're seeing and how it makes them feel. So there's one specific participant who is an American whose parents live in Israel, and she knows the human rights group that has created videos of raids on homes, detentions or beatings of children for seemingly no particular reason given, things like that, and she's familiar with that organization. And so when she's watching these videos, she's trying to, in her mind, kind of mentally find a way to explain away the things that she sees so that they would be more positive view of Israel. And the director, who is Israeli, has a completely different view. And he's kind of fascinated by this person because they're very intelligent, they seem very informed, but they don't agree on what they're seeing and why they're seeing it and what's in it. So the whole film makes you question what you are seeing, and it makes you question who you see and why you think the things you think about what you see. It's a really a fantastic film, especially about media literacy, which is something I think we desperately need more of in these times. Oh, I saw a film called Catskin, which was a very quiet portrait of a rural German family, a grandmother, her son, and her grandson that live in this kind of little isolated place by the side of a large roadway. And it's a possibility that the father and son, the son being like 13 or 14, are aligning themselves with a far-right organization. But they never really go specifically into detail on that. It's more like we don't know. It's a very subtle film. I liked it. But I'm sure I understand if people were maybe wanted more out of it than it gave, because I think it was more of a portrait than trying to make a this young boy anyway and how he's being molded speaks a lot to the possibility of hope for people who do become aligned in that way, and they're still malleable and they don't have to stay in that situation. So that was a quiet film, an interesting film. And then Friday night I got to see a world premiere. I was pretty jazzed about this one, by a filmmaker by the name of Kalikala. He has done a couple of other films, most recently Black Mother, which is an exploration of women in Jamaica and his Allah's family, that some of his family from Jamaica. Kalikala is a very distinct filmmaker, and he's a photographer as well. And he does this thing where his films, the images are not synced to the audio, so we see the image and the audio, and we know that they work together, but they're not actually synced up. And so it creates this almost kind of lyrical, poetic look to the film and to the narrative of the film. Lots of observation. So this new film that he has that premiered is called I Wow, I Walk on Water. So it's 3.5 hours, and it's really a self-reflection. I heard someone else call it a self-interrogation, which I thought was pretty apt, where Allah goes back to Harlem, which is where he shot his first film, and runs into an old subject of his, somebody that he used for photography and for film before, this guy named Frenchie, who is a drug addict and I think lives on the streets. He's also shooting this film with his girlfriend, who is from Brussels, and the film becomes this kind of this journey where Allah kind of looks at what he's doing and his kind of obsession with this guy Frenchie and how close he's getting to his subjects, and also his relationship with his girlfriend and his relationship with his family, his own spirituality. There's a lot of things going on in it, and it is a journey. He has a look to his films that is just undeniably gorgeous. And I also have seen him interviewed, and I just love to hear him talk, because he just flows, you know. He just says what comes to his mind, and it's really interesting to hear him talk about his work and his films. Saturday, I got to see, I was really excited, another world premiere. I got to see all 4 episodes of Steve James' new 4-episode series called City So Real. It's actually kind of a love letter to Chicago, but it's set against the backdrop of the 2019 Chicago mayoral race, and it follows almost all of the candidates, several of the candidates. There's a lot of candidates, I should say. It's not about taking any one particular candidate, you know, and following them or promoting them. Really just kind of showing all of these different little parts of Chicago and how they're all their own culture in a way. Steve James is a great filmmaker. I don't know how many people are familiar with his work, but he's been making documentaries for so long. You might have heard of a small film that he made. It's called Hoop Dreams. That is now in the canon for documentary film. He also did Roger Ebert's documentary, because Roger Ebert asked him to. He knows Chicago so well because he lives there and he works out of there. And so it's really, City So Real is so good. I saw a film called The Faculties, which was a film about college students in Argentina who are taking their oral exams, and sometimes they do them successfully and sometimes they do not. And really it's more of a interrogation of the process of these kind of exams. So to begin with, we never see the questioners, we only see the students. And one student in particular, who I believe was doing his exams in an institution outside of an educational one. A very good one that I saw, though, is Dick Johnson Is Dead, and I think I mentioned that one earlier, and it is going to be on Netflix. Kirsten Johnson, who made Camera Person, and who is a camera person, who is a cinematographer for many, many documentaries. This is a wonderful experimental piece that basically she collaborates with her father, who has been diagnosed with Alzheimer's, to record, you know, this part of their life together, but also in a way to try to process process the grief of eventually losing him by coming up with all of these different ways that he could die. It's funny, but it's also very touching and fascinating, and it makes you think a lot about processing grief and how we think about terminal illness. Kirsten Johnson is awesome, by the way, so check it out on Netflix. I saw an experimental piece called A Machine to Live In, which focuses on Brasilia, where Brazil's Congress is located, but the architecture of Brasilia and reimagining Brasilia as a space station in a way. I saw this at 10 o'clock and I was exhausted. I cannot say that I really sponged a lot of it in, but the sound design and the visual design were amazing. And if you want to get lit up and watch something interesting, I would highly recommend A Machine to Live In. So this comes to my last film that I got to see, and the one that I considered the best at the festival, and I mentioned it earlier in the beginning, was the Ross Brothers film Bloody Nose, Empty Pockets, which is a fascinating film about the final night at a dive bar in Las Vegas. Or is it? Well, either way, it portrays the last night of a dive bar in Las Vegas, and it is so wholly immersive that you feel like you are right there with these patrons, drinking and laughing and fighting and crying and dancing. It's hard to describe in any other way. I know I don't do it justice. Everyone should see it. It's so wonderful. One of the most creative things I've seen in a long time. Definitely one of the best films I saw this year. So I'm going to end it here. Hopefully this gave you a few more things to put on your to-see list. If you are asleep, I hope you're having great dreams if you want them, and no dreams if